أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولقد أرسلنا رسلا من قبلك وجعلنا لهم أزواجا وذرية وما كان لرسول أن يأتي بآية إلا بإذن الله لكل أجل كتاب يمحو الله ما يشاء وعنده أم الكتاب وإما نرينك بعض الذي نعدهم أو نتوفينك فإنما عليك البلاغ وعلينا الحساب أولم يروا أنا نأتي الأرض ننقصها من أطرافها والله يحكم لا مؤكب لحكمه وهو سريع الحساب صدق الله العظيم.
And with that, I'd like to welcome and also invite our guest speaker to come and share his words of wisdom with us all. Someone who is in no need of an introduction. And so, immediately, with the greatest of respect, I'm going to ask our guest speaker, Shaykh Waseem Ahmed, to come and address you regarding today's topic, which is Fitna and Test of Dajjal. Please join me in welcoming our guest with chants of Takbir and Risalat. Nare Takbir! Nare Risalat! Nare Risalat!
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا ومولانا محمد الصادق الوعد الأمين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد طب القلوب ودوائها وعافة الأبدان وشفائها ونور الأبصار والبصائر وضيائها وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد الفاتح لما أغلق والخاتم لما سبق ناصر الحق بالحق والهادي إلى صراطك المستقيم وعلى آله حق قدره ومقداره العظيم. اللهم افتح علينا فتوح العارفين ووفقنا توفيق الصالحين وانفعنا اللهم بالقرآن والذكر الحكيم. اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وأنت يا حي يا قيوم تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا سهلا ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وبعد, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. First of all, I'd like to thank Mawlana Sahib, the committee of this masjid, our elders, and yourselves for all the hard work you put in to build this beautiful masjid. It's always an honor, a massive honor, not just a normal honor. It's just really, you know, feels good to come back to Saneri Masjid, to Golden Mosque each and every time, and to see you and benefit from you, inshallah ta'ala. I want to start off with the hadith of the Prophet والسلام, talking about the signs of the Day of Judgment. Once a shepherd was with his sheep, shepherding his sheep, and one of the sheep went astray away from the flock, and you're not supposed to do that because the wolf eats you. That's what happened. the wolf was about to devour the sheep. They took hold of the sheep. The shepherd, realizing that one of the sheep is missing, went towards the sheep to look for it and found that there was a wolf about to eat his sheep. So he tried to, you know, he scared away the wolf, and the wolf replied back to him, spoke to him and said, "Why are you depriving me of my rizq, of my sustenance? Why don't you let me eat something? I'm hungry. I'm very hungry, it's Ramadan." And he was like, "Subhanallah, a wolf speaking. You know, a wolf telling me that he's hungry and he needs, you know, I'm taking his rizq." And he said to him, "You've got plenty more sheep. What's the matter? What will happen if you lose one of them? You know, I'll get something to eat and you'll still be okay." So he was amazed, like a wolf speaking. And the wolf replied to him, "Are you amazed at this, that a wolf speaks?" And he goes, "Yes, you know, it's not normal." He goes, "Shall I tell you something even more amazing?" And he goes, "Yes, what is that?" And he said that there is a prophet that has emerged in a place called Medina, in the city of Yathrib, that is calling to the true way, to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to sabilillah, to worship of one God. And he has now emerged in the city, and if you go to him and you believe in him, he will tell you even more amazing things. So the man decided to head towards the city of Yathrib or Medina al-Munawwara. And as he arrived, he put his sheep, his herd to one side, and he went to the masjid and he asked who the Prophet ﷺ was. Who was this man called Muhammad ﷺ? So he was shown the Prophet ﷺ, and he sat down with the Prophet ﷺ, and he told the Prophet ﷺ what happened. "This is, I was, you know, with my sheep and this happened and the wolf came," and he told the Prophet the whole story. And the Prophet ﷺ was pleased and he smiled and he said, "I want you to come and I want to relate this story to the companions in the masjid." So like they did, they had a khutbah or a gathering like this, and the Prophet explained to the companions and narrated what the shepherd had told him, and some of the people were surprised that, you know, a wolf speaks, you know, like, come on, what's that, right? So Sayyidina Rasulullah said, Sayyidina Abu Bakr and Sayyidina Umar believe me, and they believe in more than this. And at the end of times, the hour will not come. The Prophet then mentioned some signs of the Day of Judgment. The hour will not come until trustworthiness is lost. Until the amana is lost. There'll be people who won't have any trustworthiness anymore. You can't trust anybody. You know, shall I get this builder to the job? Shall I get that builder to the job? Whatever you get, you're going to get a budget job, right? You're going to pay too much. You know, who do I ask to, you know, sort my car out, go to this mechanic, go to that mechanic? You can't trust anybody anymore. Amana will be lost. This is one of the signs that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned. And then the Prophet mentioned a few other signs, that leadership will be given to those who do not deserve it, who are not qualified to lead. This is one of the signs of the Day of Judgment. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, a man will leave his home, and when he's away from home, his thigh will inform him of what his family is doing at home. His thigh will inform him of what his family is doing at home. Now, for a long time, the scholars had difficulty understanding that hadith. How can your thigh, this part of your body, yeah, how can that tell you what your family is doing at home? But if I would ask you all, or most of you, put your hand in your pocket, what's going to come out? Like keys, maybe? But, you know, a lot of us keep our mobile phones in our trouser pocket. Right, and you pull that out and you call your family at home, it'll tell you how your family are doing at home. So the Prophet ﷺ, 1400 years ago, he told us this miracle. It's a miracle for him. He told us about mobile phones. He said that your thigh, where we keep, most of us keep the mobile phone in our pockets, mine's right here right now, it's off. It will tell you what your family is doing at home. You will leave your home and it will inform you. You get a message, you put your hand here first, right, your phone's in your pocket. The Prophet ﷺ told us this 1,400 years ago. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, humans will communicate with animals. They'll be able to communicate with animals at the end of time. Humans will be able to communicate with the dawab, the beasts, the animals that are out there. So this is something which, you know, you might have read about, that they're researching and they're trying to find communication with wildlife. So for dolphins are the most famous example that they're trying to now, there's a way of communication. But at the end of time, this will happen. Humans will communicate with animals. And then the Prophet ﷺ said that the end of a whip of a person, the shoe of a person will speak to him. The shoe of a person, your sandal, will speak to you, the Prophet ﷺ said. Now, how does that work? For those of you doing research, there's two things here. One, they now have shoes that have mobile phones in. They're not massive, nobody's really buying these shoes, right? They're not that trendy. They're not one of these design labels, right? If they put design labels on it, you never know. Might be a good sales. But there's shoes now that have mobile phones in them. But there's something even more clear to this. There are shoes now that you can buy, trainers, you know, jogging shoes, that tell you how far you've run. It actually speaks back to you, you've done this much, how many calories you've burnt. You can plug it in basically and put earphones on and listen to your running whilst you're running. There's shoes that can do that, and I mean by the major sports companies out there. The Prophet ﷺ said, your shoe will speak to you. So this is 1,400 years ago, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was telling us about what's happening today. And there's many, many hadith like this. You know, we could be here all day, remember all day. But we could mention hadith after hadith after hadith of the prophecies and the miracles of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. This should increase our iman. It should increase our faith in the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Today's topic is the fitna of the Dajjal. And this is an important topic. And in fact, it's a very relevant topic. It's not one of those random topics. It's not one of those sensational things that, oh, the Dajjal, you know, amazing, what's going to be like, one-eyed man, or this, that, the other. It's actually very, very relevant. And we need to understand the concept of the Dajjal and the fitna of the Dajjal and protect ourselves. So there's many hadith about the Dajjal, many, many hadith. And the most famous hadith is that the Prophet ﷺ told the companions that there has not been a greater test for mankind since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam and his offspring, then the fitna, the trial, the test of the Dajjal. This is the most severest test. And every single prophet warned his people, his ummah, about the Dajjal. So it's an article of faith that every prophet will tell their people there's something called the Dajjal that's going to emerge at the end of time. And I am going to tell you something that no prophet told his people. So the Prophet ﷺ brought something very specific that was not revealed before. It was given to our Prophet ﷺ. And that is that the Dajjal is one eye. He is a'war, meaning one eye works properly, the other eye does not work properly. There's various narrations. But your Lord is not one-eyed. The Dajjal is one-eyed, is a'war. And وَرَبُّكُمْ لَيْسَ بِأَعْوَى. And your Lord is not got a defective eye. So this was something very specific about the Dajjal, this one eye. I'm going to touch on this a lot in the talk today. The Prophet ﷺ narrated a hadith. This is in the hadith tradition, this is a special hadith because the Prophet ﷺ narrates a hadith. Normally we narrate the hadith through a chain of narration from the Prophet ﷺ. But in this case, it's an example, they mention the books of hadith, terminologies. The Prophet narrated a hadith from a companion. The companion's name is Sayyidina Tamim al-Dari. Sayyidina Tamim al-Dari, may Allah be pleased with him, was a Christian who embraced Islam. And he went on a sea journey, on a journey by sea, with about 30 people. And it says that they went on the journey and for a month they were in the sea and the winds were blowing them everywhere. There was a storm and there was winds and they couldn't get back to land and they were, you know, sent away from their destination and they carried on in this storm and troublesome winds for a whole month until they were set upon an island. They came across an island and they got off of the ship onto this island. And when they went to this island, and this is important, right, an island meaning a land that's surrounded by sea, they met a dabba, a beast, that had lots and lots of hair, very hairy beast. And Sayyidina Tamim says that we didn't know the rear of this thing from its front, which was the front side, which was the back side. We had no idea such a hairy creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we said to this thing, whoa, what are you? Who are you? Tell us what you are. But he didn't reply, and it said, أَنَا الْجَسَّاسَ. I am the jassasa, a very important word. Remember this word. I think you all know the word jasus, right? Jasus means a spy. Jassasa means the same thing, but it's a more of an emphatic meaning that I'm not just a spy, I am a massive spy. Like we say allama, right? Same word, jassasa. I am a massive spy. Right? I am a spy. So why did this thing call itself a spy? What does it do? What is it spying on? Who is it spying on? What is it after? This is a big question. And then it said, and then they said, وَمَا الْجَسَّاسَ? What is this jassasa? What type of spy are you? And he didn't reply to them. He didn't reply, he didn't give the answer. But what we learn is that there's something out there that is spying. This was the role of this particular creature. It was not just a spy, like in the normal term. It was a massive spy. Spying on everybody, in other words. Like on you, on Facebook, on Twitter, on your WhatsApp, on, you know, where you go on the internet. It's all recorded. This is a massive spy out there who's tracking your every move. They know where you've gone. You know, your Google Maps tracks you. So when you turn your Google Maps on, you don't use it, just app in your phone. You can log in online and find out where you've been. There'll be a line everywhere going from where you are. Some of you heard of this, right? Your Google Maps tracks you everywhere you go. Right now, my phone will say Dewsbury because I was there, and then it'll say Rochdale, right? And then when I go back to Sheffield, it'll be on the Sheffield. I can log in and find out where I've been today. Somebody who knows my login can log in and find out where I was. Your Google Maps tracks you, right? Facebook and all these apps, they have access to everything on your phone. Your pictures, your audio, your microphones, so they can hear what you're saying. They know everything what you're doing. So there's a lot of spying going on. This is from the signs of the end of time. This is from the signs of the Dajjal. But he didn't reply to them. It went on to the next point and it said, go to the man in the dair, in this monastery, this area that's been sealed off. A dair is an area that's been sealed. It's like a little, like a room that has no exit, or you know, one exit only. And you just go in, you spend time, then you go out. There's no windows in this place. So go to this man in the day, in this place, in this room. Because he is very eager to meet you. فَإِنَّهُ إِلَىٰ خَبْرِكُمْ بِالْأَشْوَاقِ. He's got a lot of shawq. He's waiting for some news. So he wants to see, speak to you. So go to him. So we got afraid of this thing and we were trying to stay away from it. So we quickly went to this dair and we came and we saw this person. And we went into the dair and we saw a massive human being, a large sized human being. It says here, أَعْظَمُ إِنسَانٍ رَأَيْنَاهُ, the biggest person we had ever seen. This is how big this person was. And he was tied up. He was chained up without. His hands were chained to his neck. His hands were, you know, up to his neck like this. And he had shackles, metal shackles of iron in his feet. So he was locked up. And we said to him, woe be to you, what are you? وَيْلَكَ مَا أَنْتَ, what are you? And he said, you have now come to know me. You have seen who I am. But rather tell me about yourselves. Who are you? So they replied, we are people from the Arab. نَحْنُ أُنَاسٌ مِنْ Arab. We're the Arabs and we got on a boat and we got on a ship and the sea was difficult to ride upon their winds and we came upon this island of yours. And then we saw this creature, they talked about this dabba, this animal they saw, and we saw it very hairy and it told us to come to you and here we are now and it told us that it was the jassasa and now we're here with you. And he told us you're waiting for us and you're really eager to see us. So now we're here, we don't know what to do, we want to get back. So he said, let me ask you a few questions. Tell me about a few things, I want to know a few things. And then he asked about a place called Nakhl Baysan. And they said, what do you want to know about this place, Nakhl Baysan? And he said, does it give fruit? Nakhl means trees or palm trees of the place called Baysan. And they said, yes, it gives fruit. And he said, this was the Dajjal by the way, right? He said, it soon will not give fruit. It soon its fruits will dry up. And then he said, tell me about the Buhayra, the lake of Tabariya. And we said, what do you want to know about it? And he said, is there water in this lake? And they said, yes, there's lots of water there. And he said, soon there'll be no water there. Referring to the Ya'juj, Ma'juj. And if you read about the Ya'juj and Ma'juj, one of the things they do is they drink all the water of the earth. This is what they do. And one of the things they do is they come across this lake of Tabariya, which is a massive lake. And they just go past it. And when they go past it, they drink from it and it's empty. They empty the whole lake, they dry it all up. So he said, soon this lake will be dried up. And then he said, inform me about the spring of Zu'ar, a spring of water. And I said, what do you ask about it? And he said, does it give water? Does it have a spring? And do the people around it take from the water and irrigate their crops? And they said, yes, this is the case. And then he said, soon there'll be no water. And soon the people will not be able to irrigate their crops. Basically, things will disappear slowly, slowly. Water disappearing, therefore, is a sign of the Day of Judgment. Then he said, inform me about Nabi al-Ummiyin, the prophet of the unlettered people. What has he done? So they asked about the Prophet ﷺ. So they said, he has emerged, kharaja fi Makkah. He's emerged in Makkah and he has now settled in a place called Yathrib in Medina al-Munawwara. And he asked him, have the Arabs fought against him? And he said, yes, there have been many major battles, Badr and Uhud, between them. And he said, what has happened in these battles between the Prophet ﷺ, the Muslims, and the Arabs? And he said that the Prophet, he's become victorious over them, ظهر عليهم, he's become taken power over them, and they are now obeying him. So this was towards the end of the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ, because he was now in charge. So Fatah Makkah, from this hadith, can be ascertained that this was the time when the Prophet ﷺ was in charge of the Arabs. And then he said, let me tell you about myself. So I'll ask you questions, I've got my answers. Let me tell you about myself. أنا المسيح. I am the Messiah. The Messiah. Now he's the Messiah Dajjal, but he doesn't call himself Dajjal. Right? He doesn't call himself, Dajjal means the imposter, the antichrist, right? Somebody who's a false. Dajjal means to cheat, to lie, to deceive. So he's a deceiving Messiah, he's a wrong one, the antichrist. The Messiah, the Messiah, what that means, what does the Messiah mean? The Messiah or the Messiah, it means the Savior. It means somebody who comes, who will then save the people, give them good after they're in bad, after they're in trouble, relieve them from their difficulties. And that for us is Isa alayhi salam. Al-Masih, Isa bin Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. For us, is the true Messiah is Isa alayhi salam. And the false Messiah is Al-Masih al-Dajjal. Right? So Dajjal can be translated as false, imposter, fake, deceiver. It means a lie. It means to cover over something and deceive people. And this is what Dajjal does. This is what Dajjal will do. And he said, I have almost received permission. This was the time of the Prophet ﷺ. I have almost received permission to be released. And when I am released, I will go all across the earth. I will traverse all across the earth. And I will not leave a city except that I will go into it. I will go into that city. إِلَّا حَبَطُّ فِيهَا. In 40 days. So he'll do all this in 40, he'll go around the whole world in 40 days. Except for Makkah and Taiba. Except for Makkah, Al-Mukarramah and Taiba, which is another name for Medina Al-Munawwara. These two cities are haram upon me. I cannot enter. If I go to the cities, I find at the doors, at the gates of these cities, an angel awaiting and protecting me. In Makkah, Sayyidina Mika'il alayhi salam will be protecting Makkah. And Medina will be protected by Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam. So as the Dajjal wants to enter these cities, he won't be able to. Another narration, not this narration, another narration, it's a miracle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as well, the Dajjal won't be able to go into Medina. So from outside Medina, he will go up onto a hill and with his people, his followers, and he will say to his people, look at this, this is the palace, the great building of Ahmad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. هذا القصر الأبيض لأحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. This white palace, in fact, in the hadith, قصر الأبيض. And that's a miracle of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, because in the time of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, what was the masjid, what was Medina? It was made up of, you know, palm fibers and palm leaves and palm trunks and, you know, just mats on the floor. And if you looked at it, it was a very simple building. The Prophet was saying to us, when the Dajjal comes, my masjid, my, you know, Masjid al-Nabawi will be like a white palace, will be big and, you know, recognizable from a distance. And the Dajjal will tell people, this is the Qasr al-Abyad, this is for the Prophet. I refer to him as Ahmad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's a miracle of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then in the hadith, it continues, on every gap there is to Medina, anywhere you could go in, there are angels covering these gaps to Medina and Makkah as well. So these two cities will be protected. the Dajjal will not be able to enter into these two cities. However, there's a fitna. What that fitna is very dangerous. Even if you're in these cities, don't think you're safe. Because the hadith states that when this happens, the Dajjal comes and outside Medina, at the end of time, it says that Medina will get rid of its filth. يَنْفُخُ خَبَثَهَا. It will blow out its filth. And what will happen is all the insincere people, the munafiq, the hypocrite type people will be forced out. They will themselves leave Medina. And people will be enticed by the Dajjal. So they will start leaving Medina as well. So much so, it says in the hadith, that men, fathers, husbands will start chaining their wives down in Medina so they don't leave. That's how severe it will be, that the women folk will be more enticed by. Because why? They're put in context. There'll be no food. There will be no food at the time of the Dajjal. All the resources of the earth will have finished. And anything that there is will be in the hands of the Dajjal. Allah will give him powers. It's a test, it's the biggest test for mankind. Allah will give him some certain powers by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of them is that he will command the sky to rain and it will rain by the permission of Allah. And people will see this and think, you know, we haven't got food, we haven't got water. You know, and he will command the crops to grow from the ground and they will grow from the ground. He will bring the deceased mother and father of somebody and he will say to them, if I bring them back to life, will you believe in me? And he will say, yes. And he will bring them back to life. And what he actually says is that these are two jinns. These are two people, two jinns imitating the parents. You know, coming in their form, and they will come alive. I appear to be eternal, appear to come back to life, and he will believe in the Dajjal and follow the Dajjal. So the fitna of Dajjal is severe, and the Prophet ﷺ said it is the greatest fitna. And when he said this, ﷺ, and he made a great thing out of it, the Sahaba got scared. The Sahaba got really worried to the extent that it was the talk of Medina, and people were really, really scared. So the Prophet came back out and he said, "Don't worry about the Dajjal." He tried to calm them down. Said, if the Dajjal comes, I'll look after him for you. I'll sort him out for you. And if I'm not amongst you, everyone amongst you can look after himself. Don't worry about it. You are okay. Because the message was for us, it wasn't for them. The biggest fitna is for us, it's not for them. In one hadith, he even says that were the Dajjal, I think he said a statement of one of the companions, were the Dajjal to appear in the time of the companions, a young boy from amongst the companions would scare him away with stones. That's the Sahaba. That's what it was for them. But the Prophet saying it's the greatest fitna. They were scared. The Prophet was speaking to us. He was telling us this is the greatest fitna which you have to be scared from. The Prophet warned us that don't go to him. Don't think I'll be strong and I'll be okay. Flee from the Dajjal. Don't think you'll be strong and be able to protect yourself when he comes. You must flee from this fitna and stay away from this fitna. Another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, a similar hadith, he said, I'm going to describe to you something about the Dajjal that none of the prophets described previously about the Dajjal. And in this case, he said, إِنَّهُ أَعْوَرُ وَرَبُّكُمْ لَيْسَ بِأَعْوَرُ وَإِنَّهُ مَكْتُوبٌ بَيْنَ عَيْنَيْهِ كَافِرٌ يَقْرَأُهُ كُلُّ مُؤْمِنٍ كَاتِبٍ أَوْ غَيْرِ كَاتِبٍ. That he believed one eyed and your Lord is not one eyed, and there will be written on his forehead the word kafir, disbeliever, somebody who rejects faith. And every believer, every Muslim, whether he can read or he cannot read, will recognize those signs on the face of the Dajjal. Every believer, every Muslim will recognize this. And he will see the sign of kafir. And then the Prophet ﷺ spelled it out, said kafara. And then he said he will have many tribulations. Fitanuhu kathira. Many trials, tribulations will come from him. Amongst them is that he will come with a fire and a river, a paradise and a hell. And he will say to people who are in need and struggling and don't know what to do and have no food, no resources, he will say to them, come and believe in me and enter into the garden and there's fruits and there's good for you. And he'll bring them all these good things. And if you don't, I'll throw you into the fire. If you don't believe in me and follow me, you're going to go to the fire. So you make the choice. The Prophet ﷺ told us, choose the fire. Choose the fire, because when you choose the fire, the Prophet ﷺ said, when you enter it, Allah will change it into a garden for you. Change it into coolness for you. Choose. This is the choice you have to make. The word is, don't be deceived by the Dajjal. The one who chooses the garden or the river, when he enters that, he will enter into the fire. This is the test of, one of the tests of the Dajjal. In another hadith, which is very relevant, the Prophet ﷺ said regarding the fire, if anybody is tested with the fire of Dajjal, then let him seek aid with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and read the beginning ayat of Surah Al-Kahf. Fawatih Surah Al-Kahf. This is a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. So one form of protection against the Dajjal, and the fitna of the Dajjal, rather, is to read the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf. Now, if we look into Surah Al-Kahf and read the beginning, it talks about the revelation, it talks about the Prophet's concern for the Ummah, for believers, and how he wants everybody to believe and be saved from the hellfire. It talks about the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and right at the end of the first 10 ayat, which I mentioned in another hadith, to read the first 10 ayat, is the dua of the people of the cave. The people of the cave were youths, young men like yourself. Right? We've got the hadith as well, they're young men as well. And what these people did was, they fled from their community. There was a group of them, fityatun, young men, strong men, fitya, you know, people of chivalry and nobility and meaning and purpose. Not just, you know, not just a youth, not a shab, but a fitya, a fata, which is more than just a normal youth. And they, due to the fitna of their people, departed and they went into a cave. And they resided in this cave and they fell asleep, and they fell asleep for 300 plus years, as mentioned in the Quran. So 300 solar years, 309 lunar years. As a miracle of, it's a miracle as well. But what was the dua? Their dua is mentioned right at the end, in the 10th ayah. Their dua was, رَبَّنَا حَبْلَنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا رَشَدًا. O Allah, grant us from yourself, and in other words, grant us a special mercy from yourself. Hablana min ladunka rahma. From you we want a special mercy, something very, very specific for us. When Allah uses the word min ladun, it doesn't mean, they could have easily said, Allahumma hablana rahmatan. O Allah, give us a rahma, a mercy. But no, hablana min ladunka rahma. There's something very special we need now in our situation. And this is our dua today. We don't just need general duas. We need to turn to Allah for our situation in the 21st century in the UK as Muslims, because we need a lot of help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we need to make dua specifically for our situation, like they did for their situation. It's a very subtle point. وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا رَشَدًا. And prepare for us in our affair guidance. Give us guidance in our affair. Because we've gone away from these people. We've gone away from the fitna, from the kufr, from the wrongs that were being done in our community, and we've come out and we're alone. We need guidance, we need mercy, we need care, and we need guidance. So, oh Allah, give us guidance. This dua should be the dua of our youth today. To make this dua regularly, oh Allah, give us a special mercy from yourself and give us guidance in our affairs. Because we need to move away from the haram in our communities. We need to move away from the drug dealing, from the gambling now is a massive problem. Right? Nobody brings these issues up, but gambling is a massive, massive problem. To the extent many have got gambling apps on their phone. Because everything's on the phone these days, right? You can check your bank account, you can send money across the world, you can do everything. They've got gambling apps on their phone. They place a bet on the football match. They place a bet on the Formula One race or on sports. This is what's happening now. Right? And these gambling companies offering you free money, like if you join us, we give you £20 free bets, and this, that, the other, and they get addicted and addicted, and they blow all the money away. It's an addiction. And there's so many haram things that are in our communities, which some of us are not aware of, alhamdulillah. If Allah's protected you, then do shukr. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah has not put you in that situation. But there's many, maybe most of them not here, that are in these situations, whether it's drugs, whether it's gambling, whether it's alcohol, whether it's women, whether it's this, that, the other, money laundering, it's all happening out there. People are after the dunya. People are just drowned in the fitna that is around them. And this is part of the Dajjalic system, part of what's going to come and keep us away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Dajjal's job is going to be very easy when he comes. People will follow him. And we say we're strong, we've got iman, but we don't know. We've not been tested yet. We ask Allah for protection. We must make this dua. رَبَّنَا حَبْلَنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا من أمرنا رشدا. Beginning of Surah Al-Kahf, the 10th ayah of Surah Al-Kahf, you can find this dua. So please look into this dua and recite it. And read the English translation of Surah Al-Kahf. Because Surah Al-Kahf, Surah number 18 of the Quran, is to be recited every Friday, as most of you know. It was a regular recitation of the Prophet ﷺ and the companions especially. Every Friday they wouldn't miss this surah. Sayyidina Umar would recite Surah Al-Kahf in the Fajr prayers, it's made in some hadith. So in Fajr prayer, he would read all of Surah Al-Kahf. Read the Qul A'udhu bi Falaq, Qul A'udhu bi Nas, and off home to sleep. He would read the whole of Surah Al-Kahf, which is like three quarters of a spara. So imagine how long it would take. But there's lots of wisdoms and stories in this surah that are relevant to today. Because we have to read it every Friday. And it gives protection. If you know this surah, or the last 10 verses, or the first 10 verses, or the last 3 verses, or the first 3 verses, there's many narrations, then you will have a source of protection. So do not neglect this surah. It's a vital surah. Read the English translation, and you'll learn a lot from this surah. A lot about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how He works in the creation, how He wants us, things He wants to do. A lot about the previous, the story of Musa alayhi salam, and Khidr alayhi salam, beautiful story. Right, the story of the people of the cave, which I just mentioned, and other stories are mentioned in this surah. So there's some really, really interesting points in this surah. It's a surah which should be studied and really looked into, because it's a very relevant surah to our times, to the end of times. Ya'juj and Ma'juj are mentioned. The whole story of Ya'juj and Ma'juj and Dhul Qarnayn are mentioned in this surah. So it's very relevant to us, and it's something we should be aware of, and it should be now a common knowledge what is contained in this surah. So I really encourage everyone here to go home and pick up an English translation, okay, on your apps, on your phone, right, everything on the phone, and read through this surah and what it means, right, and you can try and get some understanding and maybe have some classes on tafsir of surah Al-Kahf. So that's a form of protection from the Dajjal. He will also do other things, the Dajjal. It says he will go into the sea, he make 3 dives into the sea, thalatha hawdat, so he'll delve into the sea 3 times. He will have one arm will be longer than the other arm. So his arms won't be balanced. One arm of the Dajjal will be longer than the other arm. He will put his longer arm into the... This is the wording of the hadith. He'll put his longer arm into the sea and it will go to the bottom of the sea. Right? And he will bring his arm out and he'll come out with fish. Right? Is this literal or is it metaphorical? Allahu alam. He will ride a beast. It says, from one ear to the other ear of this beast, meaning this mount, is 60 cubits, 60 arm lengths, right? That's arm length, from here to the elbow to the hand, right? A difference of opinion, something on the shoulder. But 60 of those, what's that wide these days that you could ride? Aeroplane, right? From each ear to the ear of this mount, that's the word used by the Prophet ﷺ, is 60 cubits. So the Prophet ﷺ was telling us how the Dajjal is going to work and where he's going to be. He says that the earth will be, will be rolled up for him. تُطْوَى لَهُ الْأَرْضِ So that if he goes somewhere, he can get there very quickly. It won't take him a long time to go across the earth, because he's only here 40 days. And the 40 days are going to change, which we're going to go into as well. And then it says, the Prophet told us in a hadith by Imam Ahmed, he said, the Dajjal will not appear. He will not appear until there are 2 things. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, خِفَّةٍ فِي خِفَّةٍ مِنَ الدِّينِ وَإِدْبَارٍ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ When there is lightness, meaning flimsiness, in religion. People don't care about religion anymore. People are not concerned. They don't care, was my prayer valid or not? How do I make wuzu? Yeah, just come to the mosque, pray, go home. It becomes a routine more than something serious in your life. It's a secondary issue. There's going to be a khifa, neglect of the deen. وَإِدْبَارٍ مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ And the moving away from knowledge. You have iqbal, which means to go somewhere, come towards something, iqbal. And you have something called idbar, going away from something. We should have iqbal al-ilm. We should have iqbal al-dhikr. You know, we should be going towards knowledge and dhikr and so forth. But when the Dajjal appears, what will be happening? People will be going away from knowledge. Idbar, there's a movement away from knowledge. We don't want to learn anymore. We don't want to, study. Rather, watch TV and watch YouTube videos. That's how we learn today. We don't want to study anymore. We don't want to get knowledge, real knowledge. You know? There was an incident, one of the shaykhs, he was given a tasbih to bless, right? This is what you do with the shayukh, right? And he did that, you know, he blessed it, people were giving it him, so he was blessing it. And then one brother, he came up with, some of you probably got this in your pockets, probably, right? He came up with the digital tasbih. So you know the one you press, Allah, Allah, right? So he goes to the Shaykh, he goes, Bismillah, Shaykh, bless my tasbih, digital tasbih. The Shaykh looked at it and said, we don't do this. We don't do this. You know, if I start doing this, then everybody's going to come with a digital tasbih and say, bless my digital tasbih. We don't do this. In other words, this is it's a form of zikr. I'm not saying it's bad, right? But it's not the norm. What we were taught and what we bless is, and what we use is a subha, right? What we used to learn is a pen and a paper. That's my point. You know, we learn now. I don't mind if you want to make notes on your phone, fair enough. If you want to record it, fair enough. But that's not real knowledge. That's just preservation of, information on a hard drive or electronic waves. That's all it is. When you write down, your hands are working, your eyes are working, your ears are listening, and it consolidates the knowledge, right? It's not just waves, it's not just like electromagnetic waves that, you know, could disappear or, you know, all at once. It's actually written down by your hand. It's actually you making the effort to pay attention, to learn, to record. And trust me, if you write something down, it will have more benefit for you than if you just listen to it. If you just see it on a YouTube video, write things down. This is the way of learning. And what happened? What's happening now? Nobody's got pen and paper anymore. It's the mobile phone, you know, the notes app. Open the notes and start making a note on the app. What can you do, right? This is the state of affairs that we are in. But there's a movement away from knowledge. This is going to be the reason for the emergence of the Dajjal. Two things. People will take deen lightly. It's not an important thing anymore. Disrespect for the ulama, for the learned people, for the huffaz, for the masjids, for, you know, the people, the elderly, you know, people who represent the deen, for the Quran. There's going to be a moving away from the deen, and especially a moving away from knowledge. Learning will be something very difficult or not even considered something to be done. You know, he can do it, she can do it. And if you look at the level of knowledge in our Islamic academia, knowledge in our communities, it is a calamity of today's day and age. It's the unheard of calamity of today's day and age. Like, it's really, really a disaster. In the olden days, they would study 20 years of Dars Nizami. I think the 21-year course, it was even longer, I think, 30 years even, some of them. They would study 4 or 5 languages in those 20, 30 years. They would study things like geometry and astronomy and math, and, you know, they'd be masters, and they wouldn't graduate until they didn't know all those things. Now you go to a 3-year course or a 6-year course, and then you're a big scholar at the end of it, and you get a title, and you get to do classes and so forth. I only consider myself here as a necessity. I'm not qualified to speak or to be here, but who is, you know? And if we don't fill that gap, other people will, and those people, unfortunately, are giving you the wrong information. And they're saying the wrong things, and they're taking you down the wrong path. So to counteract something out of necessity, and that's allowed, right? You're allowed to eat and drink alcohol or something haram if you're about to die. That's why I consider this situation now. That's the only reason why I'm here. If there were people qualified, I wouldn't stand up and speak. And this is the situation we're in terms of our knowledge. So going back to this idea of the Dajjal being one-eyed. Okay, what does that mean? What does the Dajjal being one-eyed mean? The scholars have talked about this a lot in their books. And why this thing that was only given, this information was given to our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that he is one-eyed. And what does this one-eyed mean and represent? It's important that you understand this. When you look with two eyes, you have a different perspective than when you look with one eye. You do it, if you want to do it now, look, close one eye, it's called tunnel vision. You only get one angle of something, you can't see around. You only get one image or one perspective of something. When you look with two eyes, sometimes it's blurry in front of you, you've got to focus in and focus out, right? Because if you look at something here, things at the back are blurry. Focus at the back, it becomes blurry here. You've got to pay attention. So one eye here means there'll be a lack of attention to things. There'll be a one goal that this has, one vision. You don't see anything else, just this tunnel vision of one thing without looking against or looking for anything else. And that goal of the Dajjal is facade, fitna, to misguide people. And that's what will be happening at the end of time. That one goal of the Dajjal is misguidance, is to get the people to go to the hellfire, is to get the people away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the truth. This is the vision of the Dajjal. This is the vision of the one eye. So Whenever you see this sign of the one eye, that's their mission, is to misguide you, is to give you misguide, sell you misguidance. They're not going to give it you. This is the Dajjal. The Dajjal doesn't say, you know, I'm going to misguide you. He sells it to you. This is the whole purpose of him being called Dajjal, the deceiver. Al-Masih al-Dajjal. Al-Masih is somebody who says, I'm not going to save you. He says, I'm going to save you. Come and drink the water, dive into the river. You know, I've got a Jannah for you. This is what is being presented to us today, to the youth of today. Come and, you know, study in the universities, right, where we wipe away your iman. And then get a great job, where we teach you how to be lewd and ludicrous, and learn all these filthy things, and go to these parties, and get promotions. They're selling you a fake thing. In the end of it, there's nothing. No actions, no reward. It's going to result in, as Allah says, haba'an manthura, scattered dust. That's what we have at the end of it. This is what is being sold to us. So be careful wherever you see this eye. And we see it in many places, right? The first internet company that came out was America Online, AOL. You remember that, right? It was a pyramid with the eye in the middle. The first internet company that came to the UK from America, right? A major company was AOL, America Online. And their image was, their symbol was a pyramid with the eye in the middle. The image of the Dajjal, the symbol of the Dajjal and the New World Order, this system. Right? So think about this. Now I haven't got a lot of time, so I'm going to cut long story short. What is the cure against the Dajjal? What can we do to protect ourselves? The Prophet told us that at the end of time, when the Dajjal is here, you want how many food? The food is all with the Dajjal. So they said, what should we do, Messenger of Allah? The Prophet said, flee from the Dajjal. You can't go and take that food. They said, what can we eat? What can we do? How are we going to survive? What's our nourishment? The Prophet ﷺ said, your dhikr is your nourishment. To say Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, this will give you nourishment. It will give you strength. Dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at that time will be your sustenance. You want a new option. If you want food, you got to be with the Dajjal, and that's not allowed. So we need to understand that dhikr is a source of strength and sustenance right now, and especially at the end of time. It'll be your only option at the end of time. Now we need to take as much of it as we can. It's our real sustenance. It's what really will give us benefit in the next life as well. The Dajjal will not be destroyed or end by us, by the human beings on the earth. Somebody special will come down from the heavens called Isa alayhi salam. That's another long story. And he's the one that will kill the Dajjal. I don't want to finish on this point of Isa alayhi salam killing the Dajjal. Isa alayhi salam is known as Ruhullah, the spirit of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he was, especially in his time, he was sent to the Jewish community, the Bani Israel. And the problem with them at that time was, they were too fixated in the laws. They didn't have any spirituality, didn't have any spirit of the law. They were all about the word of the law. So they were applying the laws very harshly and, you know, so forth, and there was no Rahmah, there was no mercy, there was no kindness, there was no inward nurturing of the soul. It was all about the outward. So Isa alayhi salam came to counteract that the first time. That was his job. He just came as a messenger, he received revelation. He taught people who believed in him, became followers of him, alayhi salatu wasalam. And then Allah took him back to the heavens. There was a fitna, somebody else got crucified. They thought it was Isa alayhi salam. Isa was raised to the heavens, alayhi salatu wasalam. And he's going to come back, and he is the Masih, he is the Savior. What does he come back with? He comes back with the same message. He doesn't bring a new Sharia. He doesn't abrogate the law of the Prophet ﷺ. He follows the Prophet ﷺ. But what he comes is, he brings his message of spirituality. And he's the only one who can kill the Dajjal. He's the one who's going to kill the Dajjal, as the Hadith says. In Palestine, a place called Bab al-Lud. You can actually Google it and get pictures of this place. It's a Bab. Babs are gates of the cities. There's a Bab called Bab al-Lud in Palestine. And that's where the Hadith says, Isa al-Islam will kill the Dajjal. It actually says, when Isa al-Islam appears, the Dajjal will melt up. So it says that as Isa al-Islam gets closer to the Dajjal, he starts melting up. You can't oppose Isa al-Islam. Why not? Because Isa al-Islam represents the exact opposite of what the Dajjal wants. Dajjal wants materialism. He sells you food, you know, he deceives you. He, you know, wants you to buy into this, whatever it is, worldly possessions, materialism, cars, you know, nice carpets, paints, you know, everything. He wants you to buy into this. He's selling you material, the sensory, not the spiritual, not the inward. Isa alayhi salam comes the total opposite. He comes with the law of Islam, he continues the law of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he re-emphasizes the spiritual aspect. And that's what counteracts the Dajjal and will remove the Dajjal. That's what, in the time of Isa alayhi salam, there'll be nobody to give zakat to. They'll go and try and find somebody to give zakat to, nobody will be good. Everybody will be happy. Everybody have money and wealth. There'll be justice and, you know, equality and everything in the time of Isa alayhi salam. Why? Because he brings that balance. He's a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he brings that balance of the law, of the outward and the inward. The law and the spiritual, the spirit of the law. And this is what we need to work on today. This is a message that we need to, you know, I want to get across to you. That out there is the materialism, right? You as youngsters want to grow up to, you know, have a nice job and a nice car, nice clothes and the designer labels. This is the Dajjal, the system of the Dajjal. That's exactly what he's going to do, and if not doing right now through his helpers, to you. And when he comes himself, he'll be at a higher level and a bigger level and more, you know, there's going to be all over the world. You won't be able to escape from the fitna of the Dajjal. Right, so we need to be aware of this. We need to counteract this. What's the counteraction? How do we repel something? By its opposite. Opposite of materialism is the spiritual. We need to nourish our souls. What's inside of us, that's empty as well. You know, you feed your body to get strength. You need to feed your soul to get strength. The food of the soul is the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is to read the Quran. This is the month of the Quran. We always feel a boost in Ramadan. We always feel more. Why? Because the Quran is recited. We come to the Taraweeh. We hear the Quran. Our families at home recite more and more Quran. Even if you don't recite to yourself, that has an effect, positive effect on you. The energy of the Quran is put into you, so you feel like doing more worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What we need to do is maintain that. You know, Islam isn't about Ramadan, it's not one month. Islam is for life. You know, a Muslim is somebody who is submitting right now, tomorrow, the day after, next year, 10 years. It's a constant, and it's a constant, what they call, ism fa'il. It's always in the description of a person. You can't take it out of you. You can't take Muslim out of you. You're always a Muslim, whether you're at work, whether you're at home, whether you're in the masjid. Islam isn't a temporary, being a Muslim isn't a temporary condition. It's a permanent job, it's a permanent role you have in your life. And this is what we need to do. We talk about the Dajjal and what will happen with him, but he is the total opposite of what our goal is in life, which is to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, connect ourselves to our Lord. He wants to sever that tie and connect you to the dunya. These are two opposites. And you know that two opposites don't come together. And this is what the Prophet said. Whoever goes towards the dunya, he sacrifices his deen. Whoever goes to the deen, he has to sacrifice the dunya. So the more you take up this dunya, the less you will have of the akhirah. So think about that. Ramadan is a time of reflection. Ramadan is a time of barakah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring barakah into your lives. The barakah of the Quran, of the dhikr, of the fasting itself, to learn disciplining ourselves, to learn taqwa, to become aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I hope that Ramadan brings a change in your lives. Wallah, it's about change. Every moment in our lives is about change. Action is change. When you do an action, you're changing. Time is passing by and things are changing. Are we changing? Or are we stagnant and stuck in our ways? We really, really need to reflect over ourselves. Ramadan should be a time where you get the book out and write about yourself. What am I doing? What have I done? What's last Ramadan to this Ramadan? What's improved? What's not improved? It's a time of review. It's a time of change. And hopefully when Eid comes, you pray your five prayers. And you continue to pray your five prayers in the month of Shawwal. And maybe fast a few days. Maybe, you know, do a few good acts of charity and help people and get involved in the masjid and activities. Wallahi, this masjid could have thousands of activities happening, but you're not getting involved in them. You know, there's just 3-4 brothers that organize the events over and over again. If you get involved and bring your friends in, if you get involved and bring people that you want, and you tell the people at the masjid, wallahi, I found this masjid to be one of the best masjids in accommodating everybody. If you want to do something, you know, the Imam Sahib is here, Sidi Faisal is there, mashallah, you're the committee members. They will really help you and they will do something for you for the betterment of the community. Because there's no point having a building without any purpose inside of it. And this masjid is there for that purpose. So take, avail yourselves and take the opportunity to do something for yourselves, for your community, for the ladies, for the youngsters. And, you know, contribute, not just with your money. Money is always there, it's coming. But we need your time, we need your efforts, we need your opinions, we need your khidmah. This is also a massive way of going to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and, you know, reaching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's two ways. I'll finish with this last statement because we finished over time. There's two ways to become a wali. We all want to become awliya, right? Great people. One is your own personal effort, and that's doing your zikr and being your chile and going out into the caves and mountains and, you know, Allah, Allah all the time, and, you know, eating very little and dressing very simple and all that, right? That's one way that used to be a common way, and people do that. And I don't think we do that anymore, but it's a way. Your mujahada, your struggle, your jihad, that's what jihad means, your struggle, your efforts. And Allah gives the openings and makes you a special person, gives you understanding of His secrets and so forth. That's one way. So it's the way of mujahada, of struggle, personal struggle. The other way to wilaya, to becoming a wali, is through khidmah. Is serving others. Is serving others, and it's quicker than your own struggle. If you serve the Muslims, if you serve the non-Muslims of this community, if you serve the youngsters, the elders, your friends, you know, when we all sit and there's things need to be done, we all sit there thinking, you know, chill out, somebody will serve the food. You should get up first and serve the food to everybody else. You should pour the drinks and not wait for the drinks to be poured. You know, if you do the khidmah, wallahi, I promise you, it's not a promise from me, it's a promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will find more blessings in your life. When you start doing work for the community, for your fellow brothers, for the Muslims at large, for humanity at large, you will find a lot of barakah in your children, in your wealth, in your parents, in your household, in your business, in your time. Allah will give you so much, and one day you'll become a wali of Allah by your khidmah. Many great awliya, all they used to do, and they serve the clever as well, they serve the great ulama. So sometimes a wali, he's not a great knowledgeable person, he just sat and studied and did khidmah of a great wali. And he himself, through the khidmah of this shaykh or this teacher, he just through the khidmah, just through the presence, he became a great wali. So surround yourself with the presence of the ulama and the our buzurg, you know, these people are special people. You should sit in their company, they have a lot to offer us. They spend all their life reading Quran, praying five times a day, trying their best to build this community. Just sitting in their presence has a blessing. You know, there's a story of Mulla Idris. So I didn't know who Mulla Idris is. He was in Morocco recently, and we were there as well. Not together, but inshallah, next time. Mulla Idris is one of the descendants of the Prophet ﷺ, Sayyidina Hassan. So Sayyidina Hassan, alayhi salam, his son Hassan al-Muthanna, his son Abdullah al-Mahad, and his son Mulla Idris. He's one of the early Ahl al-Bayt. He fled from the Middle East to the Maghrib, Morocco, the North Africa. And he became a notable person there. They loved the people in Morocco, loved the Ahl al-Bayt, and they gave him leadership. And he, you know, established the Islam in Morocco and from his descendants. In his time, there was a lady who had nothing. She had no good deeds. She passed away, and he saw her in the dream, this lady. He's buried in the town of Zirhun, I believe. And he asked her, what did Allah do with you? You know, you were in our community, we used to see you, we never did anything. And she said, Allah asked me, what good deeds do you have? What do you have to present on this day? And I said, nothing. I've got absolutely nothing. I don't have anything to present to you. I didn't do anything. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then looked and said, where are you from? And she said, I'm from this place called Zirhun, where Mulla Idris is. You know, this. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you are from the same town as Mulla Idris? And she said, yes. I lived in that town with the great person. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, since you lived with him and you're in his community, we have forgiven you. Just because you are with this person, we have forgiven you. You haven't got anything to come on this day other than what? Companionship of Mulla Idris. Mulla Idris was a great, you know, scholar, was a great wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a great man, he was a king and a leader as well of the people of Morocco, North Africa. Just because you were there at his time, in his company, we have forgiven. This is something very, very blessed, to be in the company of people. I'm sure you've heard many stories like this as well. To be in the company of the pious is a source of protection for you, a source of blessing for you. Choose your company wisely. Don't prefer. One of the signs of the agreement is that a young man will prefer his friends over his father. Right? He will listen to his wife over his mother. The elders deserve our respect. They deserve our company and our khidmah. We should always be asking about them, doing things for them, going to the shops for them, serving them. We become neglectful. Right? When you're older, you will realize how bad you were to your parents, to your elders. Try and make sure you utilize this time and serve the older generation. Barakallahu feekum. Since we're finishing now, make dua for our elders, our community, the Muslims, that Allah give us guidance, knowledge. So so that the Dajjal doesn't come. That we are here with knowledge and practicing our knowledge and making this community a better place, a source of guidance for the people of Rochdale, a source of barakah and mercy for the people of Rochdale to come into Islam, to learn about Islam here in this blessed masjid in Golden Mosque. We ask you to make dua for this. We ask you to make dua for the Muslims everywhere, especially in Ramadan, to make dua for those who are in illnesses, who are the deceased amongst the Muslims. May Allah accept our gathering and what was said, what was recited, and finish with Surah Al-Fatiha. Surah Al-Fatiha. Jazakumullah khairan. Thank you to everybody. Assalamu alaikum.
MashaAllah, beautiful and thought-provoking discussion. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we were able to remember, retain and benefit from that knowledge. Knowledge indeed is power, but only when you are able to put it into practice. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability and tawfiq to practice what we have learned today. Jazakallah, thank you for your joining us for this gathering. And we have two more topics to discuss, inshallah. Next Sunday's topic is going to be the coming of Imam Mahdi, which inshallah will be discussed by Maulana Umar Sahib. I would request that you join us for that as well. Please join us for Zuhr Salah and then remain with us, inshallah. Programs will aim to conclude around 3 p.m. Barakallah. We're just going to finish with a concluding dua. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina wa Mawlana Muhammadin wa ala ali Sayyidina wa Mawlana Muhammadin wa barik wa sallim. Allahumma rabbana taqabbal minna innaka antas samiul alim wa tub alayna innaka antat tawwabur rahim. اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم اللهم يسر أمورنا أمور الدين والدنيا والآخرة اللهم بلغ مقاصدنا مقاصد الدين والدنيا والآخرة اللهم حسن مرادنا مراد الدين والدنيا والآخرة صلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. السلام عليكم.